morning, all of you. So now we will look into one of the last solutions that we can do in this course on similarity methods, that is on thermal boundary layer with high speed flows. So far in the earlier similarity solutions, we had looked at either momentum equations without any pressure gradient term, that is the simplest flat plate case, and the energy equation without the viscous dissipation term. Also, we had looked at some of the similarity solutions for flows with pressure gradient, okay, but still the energy equation was the same throughout in all of these configurations, you know. So now we want to consider a case where you can, for example, apply either Falkner scan flows for wedge, or you can take a simple flat plate boundary layer and you can see the effect of adding a viscous dissipation term. So when is this term going to be important? Primarily, if you are looking at the non-dimensional variables, it turns out to be the ratio of Eckert number by Reynolds number. So for high values of this, so the viscous dissipation term is going to be relatively important. So we are looking at typically what are called as high speed flows. It could be incompressible and somewhat compressible, but not supersonic. So it is relatively high speed subsonic flows. Basically, that's what we are interested in. We are also making an important assumption that the properties are constant, even though they are high speed flows where relatively the temperature fluctuations could be strong, and the properties also could be compressible, like density could be compressible. We are ignoring that. We are assuming that the density is constant and also all the other properties are constant, and therefore we are taking all this out of the derivatives. Okay, so that is another constant property assumption, is another assumption that we are making. Okay, so these are the boundary conditions. So we are writing this for the flat plate case right now. We can also do the same thing for Falkner scan solution. Okay, the similarity solution for the momentum will change. Right now the similarity solution for momentum is still the Blasius solution. Okay, so if you are doing this for wedge flows, then you have to rewrite that with the similarity solution for Falkner scan problem. Okay, so now the modification will be in terms of the energy equation. So now you have included the viscous dissipation, therefore the energy is coupled to the velocity gradients. Earlier in the Falkner scan or Blasius, the energy was completely decoupled. Okay, in the sense only once you solve this, you substitute the velocities and that's it. Here you also need the velocity gradients. Okay, so little bit more coupling coming out, and these are the corresponding boundary conditions for the flow. It is very straightforward. As far as the temperature is concerned, you can either have two conditions. One, you can have an isothermal wall. Okay, and in fact this is what we are going to see in this particular case. We are going to consider flat plate where the temperature at the wall is isothermal, it's constant, and you have a very high speed flow. You have your boundary layer development delta and delta t. Now you are interested in this case when you include the viscous dissipation and with a isothermal wall, what will be the effect of including the viscous dissipation? Okay, so you can consider this problem into two sub problems. Since the energy equation is quasi linear, you can actually split this into two sub problems with two different boundary conditions. One problem is where you don't take the viscous dissipation term into account and then you assume purely isothermal wall. In the other, you take the viscous dissipation into account and you maintain an adiabatic wall. Okay, so in this case, even with an adiabatic boundary condition, you have heat transfer possible because of the viscous dissipation. Okay, so if you do that, of course the similarity solution for the flow is still the Blasius solution. Now if you substitute for the similarity variables for u and v and du by dy into the energy equation, and you don't write a non-dimensional form of temperature, you just retain the dimensional form. So this is the similarity ordinary differential equation for energy. So you now see, compared to the other case, the Falkner scan or the flat plate case, you have now this additional term coming from the viscous dissipation. okay, if this term was not there, it will reduce to your earlier more simpler form. And now this can be subjected to either of these boundary conditions depending on the case. So what I am saying is, rather than solving this directly, so there is one more way of doing it. You can directly solve it, you can define a theta which is t minus t wall by t infinity minus t wall, okay, plug it in, you can divide throughout by t infinity minus t wall, and you can define this as your Eckert number, u infinity square by cp t wall minus t infinity is your Eckert number. So in that case you can, you will find a non-dimensional form of this, okay. So this will become your non-dimensional form in terms of theta defined this way. Of course you can solve this by shooting technique just like any other ODE that you had seen before, and you can get the solution for theta, but we are not simply interested only in getting the temperature profile or the slope of the temperature in this case at the wall, but we are more interested also in knowing what happens if you put an adiabatic boundary condition at the wall, and what will be the value of this adiabatic temperature, okay. So this gives us an opportunity to analyze the case where your dT by dy is 0 and you have viscous dissipation, and what will be the value of this adiabatic temperature, okay. So in order to do that, we want to separate the problems into two sub problems, as I said, do them separately, also know, get information about the adiabatic wall temperature, and combine these two and get the final solution for the global problem, you know, which involves viscous dissipation with an isothermal boundary condition, okay. So this is what we are going to see today. So the first the sub problem we can write is the isothermal flat plate without viscous dissipation, that is your case A that I have drawn on the figure, okay. So if you have a simple profile like this, now that means you do not include the viscous dissipation, this is nothing but the Polhausen's similarity solution, okay. So there you define your theta the same way that I have defined here, t minus t wall by t infinity minus t wall, and you substitute in your energy equation without the viscous dissipation, you give, you write the Polhausen's equation which is nothing but the left hand side term of this. So this is d square theta by d eta square plus half prf into d theta by d eta equal to 0, subject to boundary condition that at eta equal to 0, what, theta equal to 0 and eta going to infinity, theta equal to 1, okay. So this is your solution which you have already done, you have solved by shooting technique or whatever. And now the second part of the solution, so this is one problem which you have considered. What will be the second problem? So one, we have split this into two solutions, one, so this is now without viscous dissipation with isothermal wall, the other should be including viscous dissipation but adiabatic boundary condition, okay. So this is adiabatic So this is what I call as case B, and if you look at the temperature profile, typically this is how it looks, you know, so this has to satisfy the zero flux at the wall, therefore it becomes normal, okay, at the wall, yes. You are, okay, so what we are trying to say, you can solve this equation as it is, Okay, so this is for the case where you have a isothermal boundary condition with the viscous dissipation. Okay, this is what we need, the solution, but we are also interested to know the solution for the adiabatic wall case. We want to actually measure what is the adiabatic wall temperature. So in order to do that, I want to take a case where I have an adiabatic boundary condition with the viscous dissipation, and also the fact that for this particular problem you can linearly superpose two solutions. It works out, and I mean that is what we are going to check. You can have one problem where it is isothermal, the other where you do, where you include this and you make it adiabatic, and the entire solution to this problem is a linear combination of those two solutions. Okay, so we are going by that method now. Okay, although we could have directly solved this and got the temperature profile, which is nothing but this which I have drawn here. We are also interested in calculating the adiabatic boundary, the adiabatic temperature. Okay, so in order to do that, we have to solve case B. Now it is also possible that you can solve case A, case B separately and keep it, and you can linearly combine and get the solution for this generic problem. So this is why I am doing this way. Okay, so assume that you have two solutions, one for isothermal case, the other for adiabatic case. Okay, you can combine them directly. We will see how we are going to combine it, and that will give your case, which is your generic case, isothermal wall with viscous dissipation. Okay, otherwise you could have directly solved this equation by shooting method. Alright, so coming to the second problem, how are we going to define theta here, because we do not have anything like fixed wall temperature. Okay, so now the first question is I can say this as something like T minus T infinity I can define, but the denominator is a problem. I do not have any T wall. So what I will like to do, generally in high speed flows there is a difference between the static temperature and the stagnation temperature. Okay, so if you are looking at compressible flows, in fact, what is the relationship between the stagnation and static temperature?
V squared by 2gp.
Okay, so of course at low speed flows the velocities are so small that you can neglect this, and therefore you can approximately say your static and stagnation temperatures are same, but high speed flows you cannot do that. Okay, so I am going to call something like my delta T, which is your say T naught minus T, and you can say dimensionless quantity will be something like U infinity square by 2Cp. So this is the delta T that I am going to use to scale this. Okay, so this is what I am going to, how I am going to scale my theta, and of course what I am going to do is I am going to define theta which is different from this theta, because this is the isothermal theta. So I am going to define the notation A for adiabatic boundary condition. Okay, so I am going to substitute now for TA into this and write in terms of theta. So that will give me d square theta a so you have u infinity square by cp, and when you substitute there is a u infinity square by 2cp, so finally you will be ending up with what, minus 2 times Prandtl number into f double prime the whole square. Okay, so the boundary condition now at eta equal to 0, what will be the boundary condition? Theta equal to 0, why it should be 0, your gradient of, yeah, so d theta a by d eta should be equal to 0, and your eta going to infinity is equal to 0. Okay, so now you have two definitions of theta, one for the isothermal boundary condition, the other for adiabatic boundary condition, and finally we have to mix these two solutions. Okay, so now this again can be solved by shooting method, right? So this is another ODE which you can write into two first order ODEs. You have boundary condition for of course you don't have the boundary condition here for theta at eta equal to 0, so you can guess that. You have boundary condition for theta prime at eta equal to 0, so you can guess the value of theta at eta equal to 0 such that the theta at some eta equal to 10 becomes 0. Okay, so this is the other way of doing the guesswork, so that you match this condition, so you keep guessing the value of theta at eta equal to 0 here. Okay, so anyway, so you can solve this problem by shooting method. This problem already you have the solution by shooting method, right? So once you have these two, now I have two solutions, one for the adiabatic case, one for the isothermal case. I want to now find how do I combine this, how do I propose a solution which is a linear superposition of these two solutions. Okay, eta is still the same, eta is I'm still, because the eta here is coming from the flow part. Okay, the flow similarity variable is still the same, y by delta, which is y square root of u infinity by nu x.
That we can equate only because in that case we consider the viscous dissipation to be we neglect that viscous dissipation.
No, this is coming purely from momentum, that has nothing to do with viscous dissipation. Viscous dissipation is affecting only the energy. Okay, as I said, the momentum part is still your Blasius equation. Okay, so the same thing applies, the same similarity variable is put into the energy.
So in Pohlerson case we consider that theta is equal to u by u infinity.
Yes,
so
no,
that,
okay,
that is only possible if viscous dissipation is neglected.
No, then you wouldn't have been able to derive a similarity variable, similarity solution here. See, the fact that you are able to reach a similarity equation shows that this is the right similarity variable. Okay, what I meant by when that was the way when Pohlhausen guessed that he could derive a similarity equation for energy. Okay, because he found for Prandtl number 1 u by u infinity is exactly equal to theta and they both the equations are similar, but doesn't matter, that doesn't mean that Prandtl number greater than 1, okay, the form of eta will be different. No, he used the same eta only and he found that it still gives a similarity equation. So here also when you put all your eta, finally it comes to this, which is still a similarity equation. Okay, so therefore the energy equation doesn't care much about the eta, so the same eta what you use for the momentum is still retained here. This is your boundary layer similarity variable, that's it. Okay, once again if you go for different kinds of flows like say free shear flows, there will be a different similarity variable. Okay, so there you will be defining something like y by ym by 2 in the case of jets. Okay, so that is your jet half width, so this is your maximum velocity, somewhere you get half of the maximum velocity and corresponding to that is your ym by 2, so you use that to non-dimensionalize your y. Okay, so in different kinds of flows, as far as boundary layer flow is concerned, this is the similarity variable, that's it. Okay, so now I'm going to just give you a general solution, and before that let us try to understand how this definition of theta, what it means at eta equal to 0. So at eta equal to 0, okay, so I can calculate the value of TA at the wall. Okay, that is nothing but what, the adiabatic wall temperature, right? So that is my TA wall minus T infinity will be equal to theta A at eta equal to 0 times U infinity square by 2 Cp. Okay, so this is how I can calculate my dimensional value of adiabatic wall temperature once I know the value of theta A at eta equal to 0. And how does this value come? By guesswork. Okay, so you keep iteratively guessing the value of theta and still it matches this, and that final value is your theta at eta equal to 0. So this factor is also called as a recovery factor. although this is a non-dimensional temperature, okay, this relates basically your dynamic head to the adiabatic wall temperature. So this is also called as the recovery factor. Okay, so what you have defined as a stagnation temperature is what? Something like say T infinity plus U infinity square by 2 Cp. Now T adiabatic wall is T infinity plus some factor times this. Okay, so it is not equal to 1, okay, but less than 1. So that factor is called recovery factor. Okay, so therefore you can imagine that this is something similar to your stagnation temperature that you have defined, but maybe of a different factor. Okay, so that factor comes through this recovery factor here. Okay, now I am going to propose a general solution which is a combination of the two cases. So I am going to define T as a function of eta minus T infinity. Okay, so T minus T infinity. Now already for the case B, T minus T infinity is defined as theta A into U infinity square by 2 Cp. That is one part of the solution. Okay. Now I want to blend these two solutions. There is a linear combination I want to propose. So this is one solution. Now here I have defined theta as T minus T wall by T infinity minus T wall. So if I want to get to the form of T minus T infinity, then I will say this is 1 minus theta. Okay, 1 minus theta into T infinity minus T wall, or so if I say 1 minus theta, it becomes T minus T inf 1 minus theta will be what? T minus T infinity by T wall minus T infinity, is that right? The signs will flip. Okay, so therefore I can just write this T minus T infinity as 1 minus theta into T wall minus T infinity. Okay, so this can be written as T wall minus T infinity into 1 minus theta. Okay, still this is not a linear combination because I have just simply added it. Okay, so I have to propose some factor, some constant which gives a weightage for this part of the solution and this part of the solution. So this is a relative weightage. I am giving a weightage of 1 for this, corresponding to that what is the weightage to this. Okay, it can be less than 1, it can be greater than 1. So this is your final form of the general solution. Okay, so what you are saying is your general solution is a linear combination of these two solutions. And how do you know that this is the correct one? So you can simply substitute this back into this equation number 1, and you will check that it satisfies that equation. That means this is the right combination. Okay, so I am not going to do that, you can do that yourself and check. Simply substitute this and you will get you can group into two forms. Okay, so one form will be of this which is already satisfied by itself. Okay, the other form will be this which is also satisfied. Okay, so those two will be perfectly satisfying the ODE. So this solution satisfies equation 1. Okay, I want you to just check that. So therefore this is the right solution. Now one more thing, already when we proposed this solution we have satisfied the boundary condition that it eta going to infinity T equal to T infinity. Okay, because the way that we have defined my theta, so at large values T will become T infinity and this will become 1 here, and here the value of theta becomes 0. So this naturally satisfies the boundary condition that this is this. Okay, but still I have not come clearly specified the wall boundary condition here. Okay, so this constant can be determined by satisfying the boundary condition at the wall. Okay, so to calculate C, so the BC should be at eta equal to 0 for the solution which involves theta, T wall should be T infinity, and the solution which involves theta A, so that dt by d eta should be equal to 0. Okay, so if you can you substitute this boundary condition and tell me what will be the expression for C? So T at eta equal to 0 minus T infinity. Okay, so this is nothing but what? T at eta equal to 0 is what? T wall. Okay, that is a fixed boundary condition. So T wall minus T infinity will be equal to C into T wall minus T infinity into what will be theta at y equal to 0, 0, right? Therefore this will be just 1 plus u infinity square by 2 Cp into theta A at eta equal to 0. Okay, now from this definition theta A at eta equal to 0 into this is nothing but T A wall minus T infinity. Okay. Okay, so this will give me C equal to what? 1 minus, so I can just take this common, so this will be 1 minus C plus is equal to this, so C will be 1 minus T A wall minus T infinity divided by T wall minus T infinity. Okay, or I can rewrite this as C is equal to T wall minus T adiabatic wall by T wall minus T infinity. Okay, so now that I have determined C, now the solution is now complete. Okay, so once I find two separate solutions, one for theta, one for theta A, I found out the constant factor which combines this linearly. Okay, so therefore I can write my final solution T eta minus T infinity equal to T wall minus so minus T wall minus T infinity cancels when I substitute this, so it will be T wall minus T adiabatic wall into 1 minus theta plus okay, so I can still retain this as u infinity square by 2 Cp into theta A as a function of eta and Prandtl. So this is my final solution. Okay, I can also go one more step, I can non-dimensionalize this with T minus T infinity by T wall minus T infinity. Okay, so I can divide throughout by T wall minus T infinity so that I get a final expression for non-dimensional temperature. And this will be still 1 minus theta, this is a function of eta and Prandtl number. Now this will be, I can write this as, if I divide it by T wall minus T infinity, this will be u infinity square by Cp T wall minus T infinity is Eckert number, so Eckert number by 2 into theta A. Now this part coming to T wall minus T adiabatic wall by T wall minus T infinity. Okay, so that can be written as, you can just check, 1 minus theta A at eta equal to 0 into Eckert number by 2. Okay, because theta A and into Eckert number that is basically this term. Eckert number is u infinity square Cp delta T into this. Okay, so that will be T adiabatic wall minus T infinity. So you can say 1 minus this divided by T wall minus T infinity will give you this final. You can just check that. Okay, so this is your final non-dimensional solution. Okay, so all that requires is your solution for theta, okay, which is coming from case A, and for theta A coming from case B, and you combine this like this and you get your final solution. Also this is nothing but your theta, right? So this was this could have been directly obtained by solving the similarity solution that I had written before, okay, directly, okay. The same thing can also be done by linear combination of these two fundamental solutions. So let us see how, if you plot the solution for temperature, how these profiles look like. Okay, any doubts on this so far? So if you plot the temperature profile, first let us look at case B solution, because case A we already know how the temperature profile looks. Case B, if you plot it as non-dimensionalize the adiabatic temperature as TA minus T infinity by TA wall minus T infinity, such that it scales between 0 and 1, okay. So at y equal to 0 this becomes T adiabatic wall, it becomes 1, at y going to infinity this becomes 0, okay. So on the x axis you have eta, so for large values of eta, so this becomes 0, okay. Small values at eta equal to 0 this becomes 1, okay. It starts from 1 and you will see the solution. So this is with increasing Prandtl number, your slope at the wall keeps increasing. This Prandtl number 0.613, this is like 300, this is like 1000, okay. So this is your case B solution, that is only for the case with adiabatic boundary condition at the wall. This is how the non-dimensional temperature profile behaves. Once you solve this, if you want to call this as number 2 and number 3, so if you solve 3 by shooting method, this is what you get finally, okay. So this is coming from solution of 3 by now for the general solution for this, that the combination of these two solutions, if you can plot for a given value of Prandtl number, that is my T of eta minus by T wall minus T infinity, okay, as a function of eta, this will also be between 0 and 1, and this will show a behavior something like this. Okay, my 0 actually is somewhere here. This is for different values of Eckert number into theta A, theta equal to 0. This corresponds to a heated plate, okay. So in the case of heated plate, you are wall temperature is greater than your T infinity. In the case of cool plate, wall temperature is less than T infinity, so you can get negative values of this when you plot it, and these are for different values of Eckert number into theta A eta equal to 0. So you can write this as something like Eckert number into theta A eta equal to 0. So if you look at the solution for this problem 3, and if you look at the generic solution here, this depends on theta, theta A and Eckert number. So you have to plot this for a particular value of Prandtl number, for a particular value of theta A eta equal to 0 Eckert number, okay. So this is could be for say Prandtl number around 1, okay. So you have to fix the Prandtl number here, because everything, there are too many parameters. You have Prandtl number, we have the Eckert number here, so you fix the Eckert number to some value, fix the Prandtl number, and then plot the variation of this non-dimensional temperature as a function of eta, and this is how it looks. Now there could be different values of Eckert number into theta a. So for a heated plate you have profiles which are like this, for the cool plate you have profiles which are like this, okay. So all this can be verified once you solve this equation by shooting technique, okay. So for a particular value of Eckert number you can combine these two solutions and you can get this kind of a temperature profile. Okay, so finally we are interested in the calculation of heat transfer coefficients. We will see how that can be obtained. So if you are confused about the definition of this, your Eckert number into theta a at eta equal to 0 is nothing but your T adiabatic wall minus T infinity by T wall minus T infinity, okay. So because this is your T a wall minus T infinity, so this should be Eckert number is again U infinity square by Cp into T wall minus T infinity, so this should lead to some non-dimensional form of temperature like this, okay. So for different values of this you are plotting this if you are not clear about how the Eckert number comes into picture, okay. So that is how the adiabatic wall temperature enters here through the Eckert number times this. Now let me also write down the form of heat flux. Okay, so now when we write down the heat flux, we look at the temperature profile, which is your general profile here. So therefore I have to differentiate it with respect to the general profile. So this will be a minus k. First you can write this as d theta minus d theta by d eta, so minus and minus, minus will get cancelled here, so this will be k into T wall minus T adiabatic wall into d theta by d eta into d eta by dy, this is at eta equal to 0, okay. Plus you have u infinity square plus k into will be a minus here u infinity square by 2cp into d theta a by d eta at eta equal to 0 into d eta by dy, right. So this is coming from the general solution. Now what is the value of d theta a by d eta at eta equal to 0? 0. So this entire term can be knocked off and this can be written as q wall into d eta by dy is square root of u infinity by mu x, okay, into theta prime at eta equal to 0, okay. Now once you determine the value of theta prime at eta equal to 0, that is for the Polhausen's condition, this is coming from the Polhausen's case. So when you solve this you naturally determine theta prime at eta equal to 0, so once you do that you substitute it and this will give you the wall heat flux, alright. So we have already done that, okay, if you can perhaps recollect. If you can recollect for Prandtl number range, in fact Polhausen did this for small Prandtl numbers, for intermediate Prandtl numbers, for large Prandtl numbers, okay. The correlation for small Prandtl, do you remember what it was? Minus half, not for small Prandtl, for intermediate Prandtl number I am asking. Okay, so that was 0.332 Prandtl number raised to the power 1/3, okay. So this can be substituted to calculate q wall double prime and from there you can calculate heat transfer coefficient. You can now define heat transfer coefficient. how do you now define it? Now this can be T wall minus whether you want to use T infinity here or T adiabatic wall. T infinity, why? Because if you look at this form right here, if you had defined based on T wall minus T adiabatic wall, this will get cancelled straight away. Okay, so therefore we would like to define my heat transfer coefficient based on T wall minus T adiabatic wall. So in that case and therefore my, so this will come out to be 0.332 K Prandtl number 1 by 3 square root of nu u infinity nu x. This will exactly cancel the temperature differences, and therefore my local Nusselt number I can define as hx by k will be 0.332 into Reynolds number power half Prandtl number 1 by 3. Okay, so now you see the Nusselt number relation is exactly identical to the flat plate case, which is isothermal. There is no difference. Okay, but the definition of heat transfer coefficient is different. Okay, now you are defining this as T wall minus T adiabatic wall, not T wall minus T infinity. Okay, now this is the difference between the high speed flows and if you neglect the viscous dissipation. Okay, apart from this, the final expression for Nusselt number is still the same. Alright, so the important conclusion here is that for non-dimensionalizing, okay, you are, there are many temperatures. You have now T infinity, now you have T wall, you have T adiabatic wall. So all the three has to be considered some way. Okay, and to define heat transfer coefficient, you have defined based on T wall minus T infinity. Okay, so everything is fine. So therefore, since you are arriving at the same correlation, your Reynolds analogy is still valid. Okay, so the Reynolds analogy, which says that Stanton number is equal to CF by 2 for Prandtl number of 1. Okay, for otherwise your Stanton number 2 by 3 is equal to CF by 2. So this is still valid for high speed flows also, because for Prandtl number equal to 1 you will still retain the same expression for between Stanton number and CF. So therefore the Reynolds analogy is still valid. Now one thing is for calculation of properties. So far for low speed flows, how did we define the property, how did we calculate the properties? We calculated them at some mean temperature, which we also call as film temperature. Okay, so this is called the film temperature, which is the average between the wall temperature and the free stream temperature. Okay, so if you can also extend this and write like T infinity plus okay, so you can write this in this form. Okay, now the same way in the case of high speed flows we have to define some mean temperature to calculate the properties. Okay, so now we have, as I said, three different temperatures to non-dimensionalize. Okay, now so already you have 0.5 into T wall minus T infinity. Now you also want to account the adiabatic wall temperature somehow. So therefore we define plus another constant into T wall minus T adiabatic wall. Okay, so this constant generally is empirical, it is taken somewhat something like 0.22. okay, so we calculate mean temperature or film temperature this way in the case of high speed flows, and then we calculate all the properties based on at this value of property at this temperature. Okay, now for the limiting case where you don't have viscous dissipation, the T wall will become equal to exactly T adiabatic wall. Okay, so it will reduce to the form of your earlier case, that is your film temperature. Okay, so you have to be careful that the definition of heat transfer coefficient is different, but finally the form of Nusselt number is exactly the same, and the properties where you calculate the property corresponding to the temperature has to be calculated in this particular fashion. Okay, so this is a very, very important thing that you. So with this, we have completed all the similarity solutions for external boundary layer flows. If you want, I can just quickly summarize the similarity solutions that we did before we stop. Okay, so summary of similarity solutions. Just 2 more minutes. So for velocity, I am just writing the global similarity solution, which is nothing but the Falkner scan. From there, all the other special cases can be derived. So for the Falkner scan, you have F triple prime okay, the boundary conditions are for the similarity problem, you are F of 0, F prime of 0 should be 0, F prime at infinity should be equal to 1. Now what is the condition, most general condition for F of 0? Do you remember from our transpiration problem? This is minus blowing ratio times 2 by m plus 1. Okay, the blowing ratio is a constant value. Okay, when your blowing ratio equal to 0, that becomes the case without transpiration, where F of 0 equal to 0. Okay, now we in the, all these cases we have made the assumption that your u infinity is of the form cx power m, okay, and your blowing ratio is essentially a constant and the similarity variable is right. So these are some of the assumptions under which you get a similarity solution. Once you get it, you can calculate your skin friction coefficient as 2 times F double prime of 0 divided by square root of local Reynolds number. So same way for temperature, the most general similarity solution is theta . This is your most general form, okay, including high speed flows. Okay, if your Eckert number is small, you can neglect the right hand side terms and it reduces to your Poulausen's equation. Okay, the boundary conditions theta 0 equal to 1, theta at infinity equal to. How did we define theta in the earlier case? It was do you remember, was it t minus t infinity by t wall minus t infinity? Can you just check how we defined it? Then you may have to flip the. For the general problem, t minus t infinity by t wall minus t infinity, that is how I think I defined it. So in that case the boundary conditions flip, okay, so theta at the wall now will become equal to 1, okay, theta free stream will become 0. If I define as t minus t wall by t infinity minus t wall, it will be 0 and 1, okay. So here my definition of theta is equal to t minus t infinity by t wall minus t infinity. So only then I can write in terms of a cut number here. That's why I did like this. Okay, so for this, the Nusselt number relation finally will be minus theta prime at 0 into rex square root of rex or rex power half. Okay, so these are the most general similarity solutions. Of course for particular cases we have derived, and also we have derived for the general case from which we can get those specific cases. So we will stop here today, and in the next class we will look at the integral method solution.